Good afternoon and welcome to In the Shoes of an MEP. That's a member of the European Parliament. I'm your host, George Stylianou, and I work for the Parliament's Visitor Service. In the Shoes of an MEP is an activity of the European Youth Event. The I, as the event is often called, normally takes place every 2 years at the Parliament's official seat, which is Strasbourg, France. It attracts thousands of young people from across the European Union and beyond. But this year, we postponed the physical event because of the pandemic. This online activity is one of the ways we fight back. It is part of our campaign against COVID-19. But it's time to introduce our guest for this session. He is one of 14 vice presidents of the European Parliament. He is currently in his third term as MEP, serving the European citizens for about 11 years now. It's Mr. Dimitrios Papadimoulis, MEP with GUE NGL, the United Left. Mr. Papadimoulis is a European from Athens, Greece. An engineer by profession, he joins us live from his residence in Greece. Welcome, Mr. Papadimoulis. How are you doing this afternoon?
Thank you very much, George. I try to be fine. It is now 2 months in which I work as an MEP and also as a vice president of the European Parliament from the big distance from Brussels, with a remote participation, but we decided unanimously, the European Parliament, to continue working in that extraordinary circumstances because the pillar of democracy has to continue working. It could be very bad signal if democracy stops because of the COVID-19.
How does it feel being away for so long from your... From the beating heart of the European democracy?
We changed the way of being connected with Brussels. Usually in every working day, I spent more than 6 hours in telecommunication with committees, political groups, the Bureau of the European Parliament. So the workload remains heavy, but it's different the way, strange the way of participation. And we vote, we speak, and we participate using the new technology. On that, I have to say that the European Parliament made a lot of steps in order to continue working in the new circumstances. Just the opposite than the Hungarian parliament, which had stopped working because the Hungarian prime minister decided to close the parliament.
We can come back with some of the concrete steps that the parliament has taken. Before we go there, please allow me to point out that, to remind our viewers that they are a major part of this. You, our viewers, are a major part of it. So please feel free to submit your questions for MEP Papadimoulis or Mr. Papadimoulis through the chat section. So back to the concrete measures. What has the European Parliament done to keep on functioning?
We have continued working immediately. Our committees, our political groups, our legislative work, we had organized the plenary of April, voting for urgent measures in order to face the consequences of the crisis related to the COVID-19. 2 hours ago, we had started the May plenary, and during that 2 months, we had organized more than 1,200 meetings with remote participation. So, and we had improved our IT systems in order to this remote participation to become better and better. But I prefer the live participation because it's the parliament is the heart of the democratic life of the European Union, and it's better to take the floor in the plenary standing and not speaking via PC or a laptop.
Definitely, definitely. You mentioned the challenges and the kinds of solutions that the European Parliament has come up with in order to keep on functioning during this crisis. But the broader picture about how this crisis has affected the Union and its citizens. Can you mention a couple of things as to what the Parliament has done in order to combat the problems that this crisis creates for our citizens and for our daily lives?
We agreed and we pushed to the European institutions, the Commission and the Council, to take more stronger, more ambitious measures in the European level to fight the COVID-19 crisis, not only in the level of supporting the health of the people, but also facing the deep recession which is coming and the huge increase of unemployment. We are not satisfied as Parliament with the measures which had already been taken from the Commission and the Council. And our priority is to have stronger tools, stronger instruments, stronger mechanisms in the European level to do more and quicker. Until now, the European response is, as also Christine Lagarde said, too little, too late. The only European institution which is working effectively up to now is the ECB, the European Central Bank. And the European Parliament is pushing the Council, governments, the European Summit, and also the Commission to have a stronger European recovery fund to support economies, to support workers, to support digitalization, the Green Deal, and also to have a stronger MFF, that means a stronger European budget for the next 7 years, from 2021 until 2027, in order to face and to give solutions in the coming crisis, which is huge.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned the economic aspect and also made a bit of a reference to the health element. How easy is it, though, to coordinate on the health aspect, given the fact that public health is largely in the domain of the member state?
I think that it's a very good question, George. I think that that crisis gives additional arguments and urgent arguments to open a discussion in the debate about the future of Europe for changing the treaties and using all the existing rules in order to improve the European cooperation also in the level of the public health. We need a stronger European cooperation, and I personally think that we need a common European health policy. It is this lack of cooperation in the first stage of the crisis was impressive, and it has increased the victims of the COVID-19. So we need more Europe also in the level of the public health. And why not a common European health policy?
So you have to push the member states even harder, I guess.
Yes. I think that we need more and better Europe. This crisis shows very clearly that we need to improve our cooperation. It is impossible for every member state, even the stronger, Germany, to face that crisis alone. Mm-hmm. It is important to join forces and to increase our common efforts. And so the European Parliament, I think, that is in the front line of that European debate, and we want to include the European citizens and mainly the European youth in that public debate. It's not a debate between the elite. It's not a debate between the commissioners and the MEPs and the governments. It is crucial to have enlarging the democracy, including the voice of the citizens and the voice of the young people.
We already have a couple of questions from members of the audience that have been following us. Before I pass them on to you, because you mentioned in your reply before about the need for a better budget, a stronger budget, the Parliament will be debating the budget during this plenary session. What should we expect to come out of this discussion of the MFF during this plenary session?
We will vote on Friday, after 2 days, in a resolution on that. I could say that the European Parliament will ask for a strong European recovery plan and for a strong European recovery fund. My personal opinion is that we need at least in the European recovery fund 1.5 trillion euros supported from a stronger European budget for the coming years, and not with giving loans to the member states, which would create a debt crisis to the European South, Italy, Spain, Portugal, Greece, with bad consequences for the whole European Union, but mainly grants in order to have a stronger common European response. And the second is that if we want a stronger European budget without distinction and fights between the north and the south of the Europe, the net contributors and the net receivers, the poor and the richer part of Europe, it is important to increase the own resources of the European budget. Mm-hmm. Putting additional taxes in some activities of the economy, trying to have a win-win approach, protection of the environment and more income to the European budget.
So let me, thank you very much. Let me move on to a couple of questions we've had. They might be handling and dealing with other issues than the ones we've addressed up to now, but it's fine. It's an open forum for the citizen. So the exactly. First question comes from Luis Alebordo Garcia. And his question is, what is the mechanism that ensures EU member states implement the EU policies? Is it effective in your opinion?
There are mechanisms, but I don't think that they are effective. I think that we have to strengthen the democratic accountability. And that means a stronger European Parliament. And that means also to use the articles of the existing treaties, to use the rules. I will give you an example. There are some countries like Hungary or Poland in which European Parliament and the Commission thinks that they are violating the rule of law. But although there was some initiatives on checking that countries for political reasons and with political motives, nothing is going on about that checks and balances. And I think that this lack of democratic accountability is a democratic deficit for the European Union. Another example is the role of the Eurogroup. Eurogroup is one of the stronger bodies, decisive bodies in the European Union, but the European Parliament doesn't have the obligation to be controlled from the European Parliament. It's another example of lack of transparency and democratic accountability. And also in the implementing the member states, the environmental roles also there is a lack of control of good implementation of the existing rules.
Mm-hmm. And the second question comes from Aydin. And the question is whether it's difficult to work in the European Parliament. We've touched upon it a little bit during the coronavirus crisis. And are there any different, many different ideas for how to do the next step against the virus?
Of course, it's difficult to work in such unprecedented conditions, but we try to do our best because we have to keep open and working the European democracy, and the Parliament is the only European institution which is directly elected from the citizens. We try to improve our working methods, and we are optimistic that step by step we will achieve, I hope, from September, to regain our traditional method of working all together in the Parliament, in Brussels, in Strasbourg, etc. But it is dependent closely with the coming steps. First, we have to face effectively the challenge and the dangers about the public health, and to organize a roadmap very clearly, but with not taking additional risks, in order to restart our way of working as it was in the past. We have to be responsible on that and very careful.
We have seven political groups in the European Parliament, anything from left to right. Is there a general consensus as to how we should move on the next day, or there are divisions within the groups as to what needs to be done?
Although we have different approaches in some things, I have to say that there is a large consensus. As a member of the Bureau of the European Parliament, who is driving the process, I have to admit that there is a wide consensus in the steps that we had made until now. And it is important to keep that consensus also in the coming steps.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Now, the broader title of our event is In the Shoes of an MEP. So we're trying to put people in your shoes. So I was wondering how more difficult your life has become now because of the situations that you have to work in.
There are positive and negative consequences. I will start from a positive. I have no flights. For an MEP during a year, there are almost 100 flights per year to Brussels and come back, and to Strasbourg and come back to its member state. Now with no flights, life is better. From the other side, cooperating with a remote participation in meetings, it's much more difficult and not so live. Mm-hmm. The democracy isn't good to remain in the windows of a laptop. So I think that there are also possibilities to read more books, deeper analysis in events, because the legislative work of the Parliament had a certain reduction in that two last months. But from the other side, we have files of pending issues which are growing up. And I think that putting again the engine starting from September, we would have a very heavy workload with pending files. For my wife, it's better because I'm staying more hours in
at home.
But I have to say also that my group, my assistants, my collaborators, although they are working from their homes, more of them in Brussels, they are working more than they were working in our offices in the European Parliament, because the amount of the emails every day had increased dramatically
since the crisis. Something more on a personal level now. You've been a member of the European Parliament for many years. You've been elected twice consecutively, but you were also elected in the past. I mean, there was a stint in the Greek Parliament sandwiched between your first presence here in the Parliament and your current presence in the European Parliament. So I was wondering how easy was the switch, or how difficult was the switch from national politics to European politics and back and forth?
Before being elected as an MEP, I have worked as an engineer and as a technical director and as a manager for 25 years. This is my third mandate in the European Parliament and will be the last, because I don't want to die as a parliamentarian. I'm thinking also about alternatives in my life. And also I'm a strong supporter of the idea that every politician has to put his or her limits in his political or her political participation. It was difficult for me to decide about having one life with more than 100 flights per year, but I had decided on that, and I had the honor to be elected as Vice President of the Parliament continuously from 2014 until now, with a very large majority, sometimes 10 or 12 times more than the strength of my political group. And I think that in the coming years, until the end of that mandate, I have a lot of things to do. But I see a clear light in the end of that tunnel of political participation in the European Parliament.
So if I would ask you, the end, in other words, is coming in about 4 years. What would be your number one priority in these 4 years? Politics?
Yes. My first priority is to strengthen the role of the Parliament in the European architecture. We need more democracy, stronger cohesion, stronger involvement of the European politics in the protection of the environment, in the protection of the democracy, in the protection of the weaker part of our population, in supporting the young generation, we need a stronger European Parliament with stronger voice, with stronger legislative role. The second priority is to have a stronger European mechanism, stronger European tools like the budget, like new tools as the recovery fund that we are discussing now. We need more and better European unification process. And on that, I think that if we continue having a European Union mainly as a common market and not as a democratic political union, we will face a deep crisis in the coming months or few years. So my political priority is to have a more democratic, more social, more environmental friendly Europe, strengthening our unification process.
Picking up from your last comment about the environmentally friendly union, we have a question which is sort of related from Raul Fretes. And what Raul is asking is that throughout the process of policy making in a topic such as the climate change, would you say that there are enough policy instruments and tools that allow for the development of climate policy? Do they track their policy development of their policies prior, during, and after? I mean, these instruments, if they exist, the tools?
I think that the existing tools and the existing money are good, but not enough. And not enough. And I think that we have, first of all, to keep as one of our first priorities the Green Deal. Not because there are efforts, public or unofficial, to decrease the importance of facing the crisis, climate crisis, because of the COVID crisis, 19. And I think that it could be wrong. And second, if we want to face and to give solutions, not in order not to have a deeper climate crisis, we have to give more money and to strengthen the existing tools, the existing mechanism, and also putting the European Union, not only in words, but in practice, in the front line of the global effort to face the climate crisis. And on that, I think that the major pillar which could push the politicians to do more for the environment is the young generation.
Mm-hmm. One very last question, again from Ivy Naidin. It's a two-headed question, but I'll ask one part of it. I will say we ignore the first part about if the coronavirus didn't exist, because it does exist. I find the second part, the second question, a bit more interesting in the context that we're discussing right now. How can citizens send their ideas for the EU? What can the citizen do to contribute to the debate about the kind of the European Union that they would like to see? How can they give their input about the next day of the European Union?
Organizing a wider dialogue, public dialogue with the citizens. In some months, we have decided to organize a wider debate for the future of Europe. I think that that debate has to include also the citizens and their organizations, the society, the civil society, not only the professional politicians. And also we have to use all the possible tools and all the possible technologies. And as we are facing the COVID-19 crisis, the virus crisis, we have to use more the modern technology in order to have more comments, more proposals, more voices. But we have, in order to give a motive to the citizens to participate, we have to prove that the European leadership has more open eyes and ears in the citizens' voice, to the citizens' voice. And this is a deep political question. I think that the better we hear the voices of the people and of the young generation, the better result we will achieve in the coming months and years for the European Union and for our people.
Mr. Papadimoulis, we are running out of time, and it's time to wrap it up. So thank you very, very much for your time. For our viewers, I would ask them kindly to stay tuned, because in a few minutes we will be joined by another member of the European Parliament, Mr. Kimpouropoulos. So once again, thank you, Mr. Papadimoulis. But before we wrap up this session, let me acknowledge, please, the work of those who made this possible, the colleagues working hard behind the scenes. Thank you, Barbara Silhan, Ariella De Gennaro, and Fiona Broker. And finally, a big, big thanks to all of you for participating in this dialogue. If you feel there is more you'd like to say about issues we raised this afternoon together with Mr. Papadimoulis, you can do so through the European Youth Ideas platform. And one last thing, we'd love to hear what you thought about this event. All feedback is welcome, negative, positive, all feedback. It would help us improve this online experience. So another tool is also that we have to try and improve this experience is a survey, which we provide in chat. So we'd greatly appreciate if you could go in and fill it in. So once again, thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, George. I have to thank also the staff who worked for that event, the participants, and I have to say also that I'm ready to answer in written questions that will be sent to my mail in the coming
hours.
Thank you very much. And
thank you. It's been a pleasure as always.
And keep safe.
Stay safe indeed. Stay safe.